All right. Welcome, everybody. The Town Center Vision Committee welcomes you to this presentation. This is our last presentation before the vote. So if you've suffered through it more than once, some people have, some people haven't, this is the last time you have to suffer. But we have a presentation tonight. It's about 30 minutes. There's going to be breaks in the middle of the presentation for questions. She's also the designated photographer, I guess, too. But we'll have questions at the end as well. And so, without more talking by me, this is Cort Blomquist. He's a member of the committee. He's going to start the presentation.
All right. Thank you, Scott. Thank you, everyone, for attending.
You want lights?
That's probably most visible. Is anybody at risk of falling asleep? Well, thank you everyone for attending this final session of our Town Center project presentation before next week's vote. I'd like to introduce my fellow committee members. Scott Bubby is our chair and our Board of Selectmen representative. I am Cord Blomquist. Ben Jeans is not here tonight, but Patricia Jenkins is. Patricia, where you are? And Ben Miller's with us, and John Tappan will be aiding me in the presentation today. We also want to thank the Facilities Committee for their work in identifying problems with the town's buildings and providing a path forward to the Select Board. Today we'll be reviewing the problems with the Town Center buildings, how to solve those problems, the conceptual designs we've developed, costs, bond, and the schedule for the project, and why the Select Board is pursuing this specific plan. I have to click the button a few times here. This is the fourth time I've given this presentation, so we're going to mix it up a bit tonight. As Scott said, we're going to stop for questions after the problem section and then several other points as we go. So I hope that keeps things interesting for folks who have seen this several times. So first, we want to make sure we know what buildings we're talking about. We'll be addressing the five buildings that make up our town center: the Lee Public Library, the Town Hall Annex, the Historical Society Museum, and the Tool Shed with Tramp Room, that is the official name. I want to begin with our highest traffic building, the Lee Public Library. The Central Schoolhouse was moved up Lee Hook Road in 1962. And set on a new foundation to become the Lee Public Library. This 120-year-old building has seen several additions. The most recent was 22 years ago. According to 2017 state statistics, the Lee Library hosts 350 programs a year, has over 19,000 visits per year, has a collection of 25,000 volumes, including print, audio, and video, has an annual circulation of 37,000 volumes, including 12,000 children's volumes and over 5,000 ebooks and downloadable audiobooks. Space is increasingly limited in the library, with story time spilling out of the story corner into the aisles, blocking access to children's books. And notice that those books are on shelves that are too high for children to reach. But the library has had to grow up rather than out due to its lack of space. Larger programs are held in the basement. That's my little blonde-haired son in the corner. And that basement is not ADA compliant. That's Americans with Disabilities Act. It's not insulated. Here you can see heat bleeding through the foundation walls. That's why on the inside they're blue and on the outside they are red. This room also doubles as storage space and quickly runs short on room. My son is the only child that we don't have to blur out because I gave permission. Other events held in the Central Schoolhouse can be distracting to other patrons, and it also quickly fills up the space available. The Central Schoolhouse also doubles as storage and a staff break area. Not many libraries can boast a stovetop sitting alongside the stacks, but we have one here in Lee. And according to a 2010 report from the New Hampshire Municipal Energy Assistance Program, the Central Schoolhouse has completely uninsulated walls, floors, and basement. Again, you can see blue exterior walls, not a good sign of heat retention. The building needs electrical upgrades, including basics like ground and outlets. It could easily reduce electrical costs by transitioning to LED. It has only a single restroom. There's the restroom. It needs reinforcement in its floors to handle library stack loads. And it has uninsulated windows, walls, floors, lacks heat recovery ventilation, and also has multiple ADA compliance issues. And those ADA issues open the town to liability unless the town adopts a plan of action to address them. Next, let's talk about the town hall. Our town hall was recently added to the State Register of Historic Places. That status doesn't come with restrictions, but it does make it easier for the town to qualify for grants. This Greek Revival style building once acted as a meeting space, but has since been filled up with administrative functions of the town. This includes the clerk, the tax collector, welfare, finance, and administration. This has carved the town hall into cubicles. This makeshift office arrangement lacks room for meetings or confidential conversations, such as requests for tax exemptions or employee reviews, which must be confidential according to state RSAs. And that's RSA 91A5, Roman numeral 6, or Roman numeral 4. Yes, that's how Roman numerals work, for anyone keeping track. Our chief of police has advised the TCVC that there should not be any access to the town hall employees or records unless it is controlled. But there is no limiting access to cubicles or file cabinets in the current town hall. Moreover, there is not room enough for those files. Instead, records are split between the town hall annex, the public safety complex, and this storage container, which has no temperature or humidity controls, making it a poor place to store records that the town is mandated to keep by state RSA. That's 91A as well, different subsection. Mm-hmm. Accessible meeting space consists of a folding table in the middle of an open room. This means that meetings necessarily disturb the work in adjacent cubicles. The committee space upstairs is inaccessible to anyone unable to navigate steps, and room for public meetings in Lee is vital. Our volunteer commissions and committees perform valuable work for the town, and because of this, meeting space should be made a priority. Next, let's talk about the physical state of this pre-Civil War building. Here you can see some of the temporary fixes under the town hall floor. The root cause of this damage, the dirt crawl space with limited ventilation, needs to be addressed. These conditions have led to rot and add to the discomfort of working in the town hall by making for frigid floors, requiring space heaters under most employees' desks, such as this one, which leads me to energy efficiency. This structure uses window AC units instead of an efficient climate control system. It has non-insulated windows and an aging, inefficient boiler. The latest engineering report noted that the electrical was beyond its service life and should be replaced. It has structural issues and lacks sufficient restrooms. Like the Lee Public Library, the town hall has multiple ADA compliance issues. And again, those ADA issues open the town to liability unless it adopts a plan to address them. It also lacks heat recovery ventilation. Instead, the building is ventilated through its porous walls, its rotting floors, and through the holes in its roof. Such as this one, you can see daylight shining through the eaves. I took this on a regular weekday just walking upstairs with my son. On the bright side, this does help to cool the town's computer server, which is stored in the same eaves and cooled by this fan. See, it's a high-tech operation. The town hall annex is the next stop on our tour here. The annex was built in 1950 by volunteers on donated church land using timber from the town forest. It originally served as a firehouse and now houses the planning and zoning and code enforcement offices. This building also suffers from a lack of adequate storage space, inefficient mechanicals, including its boiler, a lack of proper ventilation, non-insulated windows, an aging and insufficient electrical system, poor lighting, multiple ADA and code compliance issues, and dangerous back directly into the road parking. This building would not be used in its current capacity if all of the town's administrative functions could be placed together. Next, let's talk about the Historical Society Museum. The South Lee Freight Depot, also on the State Register of Historic Places, was built around 1874 and stood at the junction of what is now Route 125 and Route 152. It is now home to the Lee Historical Society Museum. This building lacks sufficient display space for the Historical Society's collection, which means that some of it resides in a damp basement without adequate ventilation. That same basement is cracked, bowing inwards, and leaking. The second floor sags due to inadequate support, and heat is provided by a direct vent propane heater with no other climate control. For a bit of good news, let's talk about the tool shed with tramp room. Also on the register, the State Register of Historic Places, this building is one of the last remaining tramp or hobo accommodations in the state. This structure continues to be used for storing town equipment, and while it needs repairs, the structural reports notes that they are minor. Finally, the parking lot can easily be as cramped as the buildings. In this case, no special event or meetings were happening at all. This was several Fridays ago after other families had left story time, the same story time where my son was sitting in the basement of the library. So that's the state of the buildings at our town center. All of them have upgrades and repairs that need to be made. The most heavily used, the town hall annex, and the library are poorly insulated, energy efficient, inefficient, have code compliance issues, violate the ADA, and lack the necessary space to serve the needs of the staff and the public. So here's my first pit stop for questions or comments. So Scott will bring up the house lights. Any questions on the problems that we've brought up so far? Is it such a thorough job explaining everything?
Well, they're all really obvious.
Okay. Well, obvious and pretty well know what goes on.
All right. Anyone want to underscore any problems? Okay. Well, we'll move on to the next section. So there's obviously multiple ways that you could go about solving these problems. So how do we address those problems? Well, after evaluating 11 possible options, the Facilities Committee recommended purchasing land from the church and pursuing a plan that both renovates the existing buildings, solving the problems associated with each, and creating a new office building and library addition to address space constraints. The land purchase cost just over $180,000, much less than the $250,000 approved by voters. But why not just renovate? We've gotten this question many times. If you add up the square footage of the town hall, the annex, the storage container, and the storage space used at the public safety complex, you get a total of 3,900 gross square feet. When the Town Center Vision Committee, working with LaValle Brenzinger Architects, calculated the program needs of the town hall functions, that's everything that needs to go on in those spaces, we get 4,900 gross square feet. So basic math shows that you simply need more space, 25% more space to be precise, and you can't get there by renovating. In fact, renovating shrinks these buildings. When you add bathrooms and make the changes necessary to comply with the Americans with Disabilities Act and basic code compliance, it makes these space problems even worse. The same logic applies to the library. You can't fix everything there without reducing the usable space, and that would make the crowding and overlapping use issues in the library even worse. Instead, the Select Board's vision proposes to build new and to renovate. This takes advantage of the much lower cost of renovation, about 60% less per square foot than new construction, while giving the town the added square footage it needs by building new where needed. Any questions about this approach? Rough transition.
Lights on.
Sorry about that.
You just leave the lights off.
I think didn't they put Rambo through this in the second movie?
I
could
flash them, but.
Well, if Stallone can get through it, I can. All right, so let's move on to the conceptual design for the town center. Here is the proposed layout. The plan is centered around building a new municipal office building and an addition to the library. Oh, and I'm forgetting all my highlights. I'm sorry, I'm on a lot of DayQuil right now, so I'm not as sharp as I normally am. There's the addition to the library highlighted for you. By building these two new structures at the same time, this plan leverages economies of scale in construction. We allow crews to stay on site, to do multiple jobs, cutting costs compared with a multi-site or multi-stage plan. By keeping our buildings on one site, the buildings can share infrastructure. Common gas, well, septic, and telecom connections will be connected to the town center buildings. The meeting spaces in each building can be used for town administration, the library program, or the library programs, town volunteers, or members of the public. And we just added something to the town center website about that meeting policy if you're interested in using any of these spaces for your own meetings. The town center buildings would also share a 78-space parking lot set 50 feet behind a green space, and two driveways would replace the current 175 feet of paved frontage. Those driveways would provide two points of access, one near the town hall, the other opposite Wednesday Hill Road, as recommended by the Department of Transportation. A fire cistern would also be added to this space, somewhere underneath that space, addressing a need that's already part of the capital improvement plan. And the buildings have been sited to allow for expansion, so we won't be boxed in like we are in the current layout. And here I want to underscore that this plan is conceptual. Things could change as this process moves forward, but we're confident that these space needs we've come to are correct. And we've thought through trade-offs in the site layout and gotten realistic, professionally estimated build costs with enough contingency that we can plan to spend less than the proposed budget. Conceptual. Any questions or comments on this so far? Just that site layout, how the buildings have been laid out or moved around. Yes?
Hi, I'm Irene Boivier. I have a question as to the significance of the town hall annex. I'm thinking if we're going to be building a new municipal office, we're going to be adding on to the library, and I'm assuming that the municipal office is going to have additional storage and all of that, then why are we keeping the town hall annex? I'm thinking, why not just take it down? Why are we going to spend money to move it and then refurbish it? And from what I got from the deliberative session, it was sort of an open as to how it was going to be used. And I'm thinking, why not put the money, you know, more money into the municipal office rather than renovating this building? And it was built in 1950. I don't quite see the historical significance of saving it.
Yes, and we've talked about this and discussed it since the deliberative session. And John, do you want to speak more to that?
Sure. The annex is shown in a new position because we planned to have a space for it if it was moved. The current plan, most likely plan, is that it's not moved. So you don't spend the money to move it or build a new foundation, but leave it in the place where it is. There is nothing in the new design that interferes with leaving it where it is.
Yeah, this space in the frontage.
Yeah, that open area where the building is. Is where the building is now.
Right.
The thinking now is that it would provide meeting space for committees and commissions. And so it would provide a place where commissions could have their files, their office space, and a large enough meeting space to hold their monthly meetings.
And it actually is old enough to be investigated for historical.
Yes, it is.
But now, it looks like there's what meeting space available here, and also when we finally renovate the town hall, that's going to be additional meeting space. So, are we like at a limit even like now, as far as these use like five days a week?
The meeting offices? meeting space in this building you're asking about?
Right, I'm thinking, I'm including this as part of the town that this must be, well, like tonight we're having a meeting here.
Correct. The long-term plan for this building when it was built is that it was supposed to be adequate for the emergency services for 50 years. Mm-hmm. And so it was sized for that. It was not expected that the second floor would be used for meeting space. But because the emergency services we're now only about 15 or 16 years into that 50 years. The emergency services, particularly fire, department has not expanded to the point where it needs this space. So we're still able to use this for public meeting space. But it's not expected that we would be able to use this for, necessarily be able to use this for public meeting space into the future. We do now have a number of evenings when committees or commissions, you ask for meeting space and there isn't space available. That room is used, this room is used, downstairs is used. So if something is also happening at Town Hall, the space isn't available. Now, part of that is because people prefer not to have meetings on Sunday afternoons or Friday nights, but most of the people that are holding those meetings are volunteers working for the town. So the thinking is that right now is that rather than move it, you leave it where it is. There would be some plan to renovate it, but the actual decision on renovating it and how much is spent on it can be postponed because it does not have to be moved to start the construction.
Yeah, it also provides a space for committees and commissions to meet while the town hall is being renovated, because that space would be inaccessible to them once the municipal office building is complete and the town hall renovation begins.
In other words, the money that you guys are putting, that you're saying you're going to take build this with right now, you're not going to put any money for a foundation underneath that 1950 building, the old fire station.
Yeah, we would leave it where
you're
it
not
is.
Going to do anything.
Yeah, that's right. Instead, we think that the money would be better spent insulating it or otherwise renovating it than moving it.
And the commissions, the three commissions that we have, they have a significant amount of documents and files, and they're used during their meetings. So Conservation Commission, I know in particular, and also the others, people come to those public meetings, they ask questions, and often that goes to, you've got to get some document out of a file that needs to be there available at the meeting. So that's why they would make good meeting space, particularly for commissions.
Any other questions about this layout? I hope we answered that sufficiently. I'll advance forward here. Okay, I'll start going through the buildings one by one. So we'll start with the Lee Public Library. The proposed addition to the library would extend the building eastward and add 3,900 square feet to the existing footprint, including a full conditioned but not finished basement. And this building has been cited for potential future expansion. Here's a view of the front of the expanded library. The new library layout creates a dedicated office space for the staff, a central circulation desk, new fully accessible restrooms, the New Hampshire room, a meeting room and special collection space for local and state books, a periodicals and reading area, a space for expanded collections of audio, adult fiction, nonfiction, and public computers. The new display area would be located next to the circulation desk and would allow the library staff, which would allow the library staff to see nearly all of the new library from a single workstation, which would be adjacent to the periodicals reading area pictured here. The new design would further create a dedicated young adult section and a children's section, which would be separated from the adult area, making children's programs less distracting to other patrons. Here's a rendering of the children's section. Notice that unlike the current children's section, all of the shelves are accessible to small children. And there's a dedicated story time space, so there will be no more sitting in the aisles. The central schoolhouse would become a dedicated gathering and event space with two additional accessible restrooms, and a kitchenette that can serve the needs of the public and the library staff. This meeting room, along with the New Hampshire room, could be used not only for library-run events, but town functions and events organized by the community, capitalizing on this shared town center vision. All right, the renovation of the existing library is one of two areas of this project where the town can leverage funding sources outside of the town. Because of the historical nature of the central schoolhouse and its proposed use as a community meeting center, it is well suited for grant applications. The Lee Public Library Community Center Foundation has also pledged to raise the funds for this portion of the library building, with funds already secured to go towards elements of the project, like the children's area. This addition would improve access to the library's collection and meeting spaces for all residents, and that collection would be allowed to be retained and to grow rather than be discarded as it is now. Any questions or comments about this section? Excuse me while I hang up.
I got a question.
Question.
Yeah, what's going on in the basement?
The new addition would have a fully conditioned basement, simply because I believe the construction details, and John, you can back me up on this, were that to build a foundation alone, we'd have to dig so deep that we have maybe 6 out of 8 feet of a basement already dug, something like that, or?
The plan is to build full basements under both the addition to the library and the new office building, and they would be conditioned space, meaning that they're insulated, and the physical plant could heat them, but they would not be finished. And this is, we do have uses in the office building for the utilities would be in the basement, the IT room would be in the basement, there would be some storage in the basement, storage that we are, things that we're storing now that would be in the basement, but most of the area would be for future uses. And the thinking is that if you do put in the full basement now and make it conditioned space, then it's available for whatever you may want to do with it 15 or 20 years from now, the next generation perhaps. And it's much cheaper to do that now while you're building the building than to try to retrofit afterwards. A building with a basement is also easier to modify rather than a building on a slab where plumbing is rerouted with a jackhammer.
Any other questions about the library? I'll move on to the next section. Okay, let's talk about the municipal office building. This building will create a 4,840 square foot home for the town's customer service functions, again including a full conditioned but not finished basement. This will mean bringing together the functions in the current town hall and town hall annex and doing away with storage containers altogether. This building has also been cited for expansion, reducing future expansion costs. The layout would better serve the residents of Lee by creating a lobby with service windows, allowing convenient access to administration, the town clerk, code enforcement, and planning and zoning, while providing for a more secure environment for staff and much improved security for town records. The public would be able to freely access the lobby, two public restrooms, and the service windows. And those needing more access could be buzzed in through access control doors. There. This approach tries to find a balance between security and keeping Lee's Town Center friendly and approachable. It puts customer service functions up front while keeping offices and files safe. I've made sure to note that this design is conceptual, as the layout of the offices behind the lobby still need refinement, but the concept of an open lobby with access control is key to the design of this building. The new layout provides space for secure record storage, offices or workstations for focus work, dedicated meeting space, and room for confidential discussions, ensuring compliance with state RSAs. Finally, the municipal office building will feature up-to-date electrical, mechanicals, and insulation, creating a much more efficient space. No more space heaters, window AC units, or ventilating through holes in the eaves. Any questions or comments about this building?
That include all the safety glass and everything?
Yeah, so I believe that...
Won't be coming forward another year or two that we're going to put safety glass in this place so people can't shoot into the offices?
Oh, John, you can comment on the windows.
That actually still hasn't been determined, so...
Why not?
Because we are at the conceptual design stage, and so...
One of the things, Jimmy, is we work with the police chief in terms of safety. So one of the things that we've learned, at least I've learned from the police chief, is we could put up safety glass, bulletproof glass, on the like windows in front of the service areas and stuff. But the thing is, if anybody wants to shoot you, they can shoot through the wall. So unless you do the whole thing.
That ain't it, what I'm talking about. Yeah. I realize that myself. Yeah. But I'm just saying, but you guys come forward and want after we built something, well, we got to do this, we got to do that. You did that with this safety complex.
Well, downstairs we have bulletproof glass for the Robin. That's there, but that's not the plan. But we're working with the police chief and also the fire chief, also with the other departments to make sure that we've got everything as right as we can. I can't guarantee we'll never come back to you 20 years from now and say...
I didn't say 20 years.
Well, the year after.
I don't believe I'll be here in 20 years.
Yeah, yes, you will.
I don't believe it.
I think so. So we're doing our due diligence to talk with these people that are experts on those particular things to make sure we've got everything right as much as we can. So we're spending time to do that. So one of the things we found out... I don't know if you scroll back to where the annex is. One of the things, since the annex isn't moving, one of the things that the highway department had in terms of, okay, you got this big parking lot, where are we going to put all the snow? So that kind of solves one of our particular issues we have, but we're talking with each one of these departments to find out what's the issue. Is there any issues? And making sure that we've covered as many as we can. We're not perfect. We're going to do the best that we can. And the other thing is, when John mentioned this is conceptual, as we get into the process to doing as-built drawings for the building, they're going to have public input sessions, so you can come and see. Maybe we've missed something. Hopefully somebody will catch things that we might have missed. But that's the plan. So.
We've exchanged a few messages. About all today and all the time.
So. We've exchanged a few messages with the police chief, and his main concern was access control. And making sure that people can be seen coming and going out of the building.
One of the things we've included, there's a video system for this whole structure, kind of like what we have here in this building, and also what's going to be at the transfer station. So people are going to be videoed. There's also response buttons, panic response buttons for the people at those particular windows. So if they see something that's not quite right, they can press the button and have one of the particular officers come and deal with the situation. So we're looking out for the employees. Hopefully this never happens in Lee, but as you know, other towns have experienced, you know, people coming in and doing things. So we don't want that happening to our people. So
all right. I can move on to talking about the town hall. So with the new office building, what happens to our town hall? Our town hall would be returned to its original function as a public meeting space at the heart of our New England tradition of self-governance. The clerk's office could serve as a dedicated office or file storage space for committees and commissions. The second floor would also be renovated and be available to those who could access it. And if there were a similar office downstairs, it would not be ADA compliant like it is now, because there would be parity or a comparable space accessible to those who can't make the second floor. And of course, the renovation would also fix the floor and the crawl space below, replace the electrical and mechanicals, add insulation, and repair the structure. And a kitchenette would be added to allow for refreshments, making this a perfect place to host dances, just as it did in
1846.
Which year, Scott?
46.
46. I've got it right on this slide, but I wanted to make sure I corrected it.
I believe it's 46.
All right, 1846. So the town hall is a second area of this project where Lee can leverage funding sources outside the town. The town hall can't be renovated until the municipal office building is complete and the staff are relocated. During that time, the select board has proposed setting aside $200,000 over 2 years in a separate capital reserve fund toward the town hall's renovation. By dedicating these funds towards the project, but not fully funding the project, the town will be able to pursue grants such as the New Hampshire L-Chip or Moose Plate programs, which are usually awarded as matching funds. This approach, just like the library renovation, reduces the cost of this project to the town and allows Lee to build on the efforts of its Heritage Commission, who worked to add our town hall to the State Register of Historic Places. Any questions or comments about this town hall renovation portion of the project? Yeah, I'll move, keep trucking along here. The Historical Society could also pursue similar grant funding thanks to its state register status, but the committee recommends only doing so after the town hall project is complete. We don't want the town competing against its own grant applications. And this is just common sense advice that we've received from lots of folks familiar with this. The Historical Society needs to be moved away from the library in order for the library to expand. That's illustrated there. But this relocation would also solve the museum's foundation issues, as it would be placed on a new basement on the east side of the expanded town center. The current plan shows the town hall annex being relocated like this, but the committee has since spoken about this and has suggested leaving the town hall annex where it is, which is in that yellow box at the bottom center of that layout. Finally, there's the tool shed, our little bit of good news in all of this. Its modest structural needs, which were talked about in one of the engineering reports on all of these buildings, can be easily addressed with local labor. Any questions or comments about the Historical Society, Museum, the Town Hall Annex, or the Tool Shed? Yes?
Excuse me, I have some general questions. I notice you're increasing the size of the parking area. Have you considered the use of asphalt that is permeable? Because you are increasing that area tremendously. I'm sure you've thought of that. And the other thing is, what about solar panels on these buildings? Because it looks as if you're going to get a lot of sunshine, and that could possibly be helpful in the future.
All right, I'm going to ask my beautiful assistant, John, to help me.
I'm sure you've thought of those things.
Yes, we have.
Yes, pervious paving has been considered.
Yes.
There are significant upfront costs with
it. I'm aware of that, yes.
And there are considerable maintenance costs with it.
Yeah.
And it's maintained in a different way than the way that we currently maintain our paved roads and parking areas of the town. This area is in the Aquifer Conservation District.
Mm-hmm.
That is a significant issue, and right now what's been priced is not pervious paving. Really looking into the details of that is for later. Low impact development is planned. Providing features green infrastructure that handles rainwater runoff locally rather than collecting it with gray infrastructure and collecting it off of all of the surfaces, mm-hmm. and having one large pond. It's planned to be done area by area. Right now, the design plan, the only feature that's shown is an infiltration swale on the south side of the parking lot, but other small features would certainly be included. And the pervious paving has not been ruled out.
Okay.
But
we also talked about only having curbing on the site layout is nice in this way. The area that faces the buildings is also what's nearest to the wetland, so that would prevent water flowing this way, but it can go this way. Mm-hmm. That also prevents cars from rolling into the buildings, which is also nice. So solves two problems.
And solar panels, what about solar panels?
Okay, the select board has expressed that they would prefer not to have panels on the buildings. That issue came up when we were talking about putting panels on this building. There is the 4.6 acres that was purchased. There is room here for solar array ground mounted. That hasn't been, it's not part of this project. The energy committee is working on that. Right now, this building is by far the largest consumer of electricity of the three town areas, town center, transfer station, public safety complex. Public safety complex consumes more electricity than those other two places put together. So first order, this is a place where you want panels. The orientation of the buildings, as shown, is not quite ideal for panels on the roof. It faces, these face approximately 30 degrees off of south.
Oh, okay. Looks like it's a southern exposure to me.
It's about 30, 31 degrees off of south.
I think on
Mass Road, Mass Road at that point, it's shown as if it was running east-west, but it's actually about 31 degrees off of east-west. That's rotated just to make it fit in the picture. Yes?
You mentioned the wetlands out back. That's more than a wetlands. It's a very significant environmental feature. It's a glacial kettle bog. It's a spruce bog, and it's unique. There's a few of them in the area here. Now, how do you keep... I guess my question has to do with a buffer. We recognize that as a significant feature. And in some of the photographs you had or the portrayals you had, it didn't show too much of a buffer with the kettle bog.
The library itself right now, at the building that's there, a very large fraction of that is in the 75-foot setback from the bog. The tool shed where it is not within the 75-foot setback, but that storage container, which would leave right now, is in the 75-foot setback. And the library addition, a small corner of it where it connects to the existing structure, right about there, a small corner of that would be within that 75-foot setback. The new office building is entirely outside of that 75-foot setback. Runoff from the buildings and from the parking lot would be designed so that most of it is handled going away from the bog. And the soil types that are there have very high infiltration rates.
Well, that was my next question. You may have already answered it, but there's very significant flora and fauna in these bogs, these spruce bogs.
Yes, in the bog.
It's very important to protect that and to drain away from them.
Yes, that is what's planned. And luckily, this ground is fairly flat. Mm-hmm. There's about a 4-foot elevation range from the highest to the lowest in the building area. In the parking lot area, it does tend to slope toward Mass Road and toward the east, away from the bog.
Okay, this has been a design feature with the bog in mind, or just happenstance?
We didn't change the ground contour that's there, but yes, we had the 75-foot setback planned, and when we talked about how does water drain off of the parking area and where do you lead it to, it was going away from the bog.
And what's in the setback? Is it natural vegetation, or has it been cleared, or what's the plan for the setback?
It's
area.
Right now it is vegetated, except for more than half of the library right now is in the setback. I mean, that's what was done generations before us.
Yeah.
And like I said, the storage container is in the setback. But the rest of the setback, except for a small walking area around the back of the library, the rest of it is naturally vegetated and would stay that way.
when the committee set out on this project, our goal was to respect all of the town setbacks, and actually, in meeting with the architects, they said, well, why don't you just build, you could just build closer, I mean, you set the rules. So just waive the rules for yourself, and we could change things around like this, and we stuck to, no, we want to stay within the town's rules. The town shouldn't set rules that it can't follow itself, and we've stuck with that everywhere other than a little sliver of grandfathering involving the library. Let me get back to where we were.
Excuse me?
Oh, yes.
How many commissions does the town have? Commissions or committees?
Scott, you're a selectman.
three commissions.
Yep. What is it? Agricultural Commission, Heritage Commission,
Conservation Commission.
In terms of committees, ooh.
Energy.
Yeah, the energy, there's the Town Center Vision Committee.
Sustainability.
Sustainability Committee. Advisory Budget Committee. There's a list on the website. I can't tell you all of them. I'm probably missing some. The Joint Laws Committee.
Is it their emergency management?
Yeah, the EOC. Yep.
I ask because there's a fair amount of meeting space added, and I wonder if there's any data on, like, usage of meeting spaces and whether those spaces will just sit empty for a fair amount of time.
If you were to look at how many hours are the meeting spaces empty, yes, they're empty much more than they're used.
Mm-hmm.
And part of that, I mean, the main reason for that is that the big user of those meeting spaces are town volunteers.
Right.
I'm a trustee of the trust funds, and I can tell you that we are probably the only group, one of the few groups, that we hold meetings on Friday nights and we hold meetings on Saturday afternoons, and because we just happen to have members who are able to do that. But most of the volunteer committees and commissions, people work during the day, so meetings have to be in the evenings. And that means that there's a priority put on, like meetings starting from 6:30 or 7 p.m. And people also prefer to have meetings on Monday, Tuesdays, and Wednesdays, and maybe Thursdays, and definitely not Fridays.
It's also easier for the public to attend those meetings.
Yeah.
So you schedule meetings at...
For sure.
We've had meetings recently at 1 p.m. on Wednesdays or Tuesdays. I have a one-year-old child I have to take to daycare and things. It's hard for me to make that, but it's also very hard for the public to attend those things. So I think transparency is part of the problem there, too.
Well, in addition, if you were to look at the town center calendar, you'll see the meetings that are advertised to the public meetings. What you don't see on the town center calendar is meetings that are not town meetings open to the public. So we also have departments that use meeting space. Mm-hmm. Fire department uses meeting space. Those are fire department training sessions. They're not open public meetings.
Mm-hmm.
And then other groups within town are able to sign up for meeting spaces. They don't get the first priority, but those don't show up on the calendar also because they're not town functions.
Mm-hmm.
So the town calendar does not show you the full meeting space use.
If, for instance, last week when there was no school, they had an active shooter at the Massway School. And so
drill.
They didn't have an active shooter, it was a session. No. All right. Point taken. So they had different groups from, I think the Seacoast SWAT was the one that was actually leading it, but they had different area police officers here participating. And so they had that in the morning, and in the afternoon, they had a session here, and the whole room downstairs was filled with police officers. So if you came into the parking lot, there's a lot of police cars, and you're thinking, oh my goodness, what's happened? But if you come in here, they're all in there, and they're getting trained in terms of, you know, what they did, what they didn't do. And so that wasn't necessarily on the calendar, but that was another use that this building goes through. So faces are very active, like John said. If you want to meet on a Friday afternoon, place is wide open. Sunday or Saturday, place is wide open. If you want to get a room on a Thursday, Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, sometimes it's really hard, so.
So may I ask, what's the total number of meeting rooms?
There are two in the municipal office building. There's a small and large meeting room.
Yeah, the small one is a small conference room for 4 to 6 people, and we don't have any design where that is available other than to town staff. There is a larger meeting room, conference room, for about 12 people, and we do have a method whereby that would be available to committees and commissions or town, other town functions after hours. In the town hall, I think I should correct what was shown on an earlier drawing. The downstairs town hall, the town clerk tax collector's office was shown as in that drawing as being a space for committees and commissions. Mm-hmm. That was our earlier thinking. More current thinking is that with the town hall being a large meeting space, if you're going to be able to do different kinds of functions in there, then you want to have a place where you can store the tables and chairs. You would rather not take up space inside the meeting hall with that little kitchenette. And if in the future the select board was to hold select board meetings in the town hall, they would need to have a small meeting room adjacent for a non-public session. So the current thinking is that town clerk tax collector space, if there's meeting space there, it would be just a small meeting space. And the rest would be to provide an area for, so that you don't have to carve out storage space and little kitchen space in the large meeting areas. So there would be one large meeting area there. It's about 1,200 square feet, which is larger than the 974 in this room. The upstairs, we have no plan to make the upstairs ADA accessible. So that's, groups could use it, but you can't count on having a town function there. And then in this building, as I mentioned, the long-term plan is that this meeting space up here may not be available as the fire department needs may grow over the next couple of decades.
Oh, don't forget the library space too.
Library has, in the plan right now, there's the small New Hampshire room, which is a space for like 6 people. And then the old schoolhouse becomes meeting space.
Yeah, this shows 8.
Oh, 8. And then the old schoolhouse, that north half of it, is meeting space for about 40 people. It's smaller than this one here.
So I think the answer to your question, this is a total of 5.
Two
in the municipal, two in the library, and then the town hall, and then the annex would serve for commissions as well. But it would really be for that purpose alone. We wouldn't be renting that out to local nonprofits and things like that. It would only be for commissions and committees, because there'd be access to file cabinets in there. I don't know if you've ever had a 1-year-old start daycare. I've been sick for 5 of the last 6 weeks. We're consuming a lot of antibiotics in the house, okay.
I know some mothers that are too.
Oh, I'm sorry, I need to wrap up one last section, then I'll turn things over to John. I've mentioned it already, but I wanted to talk a little bit about the stages of the project. So here's our basic approach to how the stages of this project would work. The first step would see the Historical Society and the first step would see us solicit competitive bids for final design and construction. We would then see the Historical Society and the Korean War Memorial moved before construction begins on the municipal office building and the library addition. For those not familiar, the Korean War Memorial is very close to the Historical Society, has to be moved to the library addition. The town hall functions would then move to the municipal office building once it's complete, and the library functions would move into the library addition space. Then renovation of the current library space would begin once the funding is secured and from the Lee Public Library Community Center Foundation. And the library would then occupy its renovated space and addition. The town hall renovation would then begin after its grant money is secured. Any questions or comments just about that general approach of the staging? Okay, well, I'll turn things over to John to talk about the project schedule, which is more precise than the staging and the costs and the bond.
The conceptual project schedule is presented in two versions. In the optimistic version, the design would be completed and the construction company hired by October 2019. New construction would be completed by July 2020. And renovations would be completed by that winter, provided funding had been secured on time. In the more realistic schedule, design completion and construction company hiring could take up to a year, because new construction would not start until springtime, and renovation would start the following spring and finish by the fall of 2021. This may not be detailed enough to elicit any questions or comments, but are there any? Okay. We'll go on to conceptual project budget. Old-fashioned system here. Conceptual project budget is based on an estimate from the project architect and three estimates from two independent cost consultants and by owner cost estimates from vendors. The library addition costs $1.12 million. Municipal office building costs $1.56 million. And site development, which includes land clearing, relocating the museum, repurposing the annex, and installing utilities, parking lots, walkways, and landscaping, costs $997,000. And contingency at 10% is $368,000. And bond counsel may be up to $14,000. For a total of $4.06 million. The separately budgeted town hall renovation is expected to cost $398,000, and renovation of the existing library building is expected to cost $300,000. Funding sources. The town has existing capital reserve funds to draw on, and the balance will come from a bond. Total cost is $4.06 million. And from the town building's capital reserve fund, the capital improvement plan shows expected withdrawals of $34,000 for town center buildings in the next 2 years, and leaving a balance of $93,000, an additional $95,000 could be withdrawn for a total of $129,000. At the beginning of the coming fiscal year, the Lee Library Building Capital Reserve Fund will have a balance of $375,000, and there is $60,000 in the Library Capital Reserve Fund, originally intended for the Library Community Center, and now available for building or adding to the current library. The remainder, $3.495 million, would come from a bond. Are there questions or comments so far?
When is that around? The bonds done on our recycling center and the safety complex.
That'll show up in a chart that comes up. It shows not just the schedule of that, but also the amounts. Anything else? A level principal 20-year bond is proposed. The repayment of principal shown in blue is nearly the same each year, and as the remaining loan balance decreases, the interest payments shown in orange also decrease. The net interest cost for 20-year bonds issued by the New Hampshire Municipal Bond Bank on January 9th was 3.05%, which was a decrease from the 3.24% this past June. An interest rate of 3.5% is used here. If the bond was issued in the second half of fiscal year 2020, then there would be no payment until fiscal year 2021. So that interest payment in 2020 would be postponed until 2021. Tax rate increase for the town center project. This chart shows the tax rate amounts that support the current debt service and the amounts that would support the proposed town center project. The reference level is the current tax rate, which includes 16 cents to pay for the public safety complex bond retiring in fiscal year 2023, and 8 cents to pay for the transfer station bond retiring in fiscal year 2024. These amounts decrease each year. In fiscal year 2020, the town center bond would add 16 cents, and the appropriation to the new renovating town hall capital reserve fund would add 11 cents to the tax rate. This amount becomes 32 cents the following year when it's expected that $150,000 would be added to that reserve fund. When the first repayment of principal occurs in fiscal year 2021, there's also predicted to be an increase in operating and maintenance costs due to the increase in town building floor area and an increase in insurance premiums for the increased building value. This is estimated to add 11 cents to the tax rate, and this includes a maintenance staff increase of 20 hours per week, but it does not factor in any building efficiency improvements. In fiscal year 2020, the project tax rate increase above today's rate is 26 cents. The largest increase is in fiscal year 2021, when the added debt service, plus increased operating and maintenance, plus the appropriation for town hall renovation, will have added $1.05 to the tax rate. In fiscal year 2022, this amount drops to 70 cents. What effect would this tax rate increase have on the tax bill? This year, the median house value in Lee is $229,500. This property valuation would see a tax increase of $59 in fiscal year 2020 and $241 in fiscal year 2021, dropping to $159 in fiscal year 2022. These amounts are not cumulative. They are relative to the baseline of today. We do have a handout which shows this project's tax increase for other property values, and that's available. Scott has it. It's available after the presentation. And are there any questions or comments on this part? Okay, then back to you, Cord. Thank you. All right, I should mention here that all of the figures and charts that John used are available at leetowncenter.org. Now I'll wrap things up by talking about the advantages of this approach and why we want to move forward now. I shouldn't say we, I should say the Select Board. We are their humble servants. This plan allows Lee to be proactive, addressing problems with the town's buildings before they become worse, potentially displacing town functions and employees. Other municipalities have been forced to rent temporary office space when neglected buildings have failed, and we've already had a selectman fall through the floor of Town Hall.
look for the patch near the copy machine. It's unwise to continue spending money on heating uninsulated floors, heating uninsulated basements, powering window AC units, running space heaters, and other temporary fixes. Investing in a comprehensive and well-planned solution to our town's needs would break the cycle of Band-Aid solutions. This plan solves the town's space needs. The town's space needs will only be made worse by renovation alone. Again, this is my comprehensive math slide. So we can only solve those problems through adding on. This plan also allows our town to preserve its history in a way that makes financial sense. Only building new when we need to, and by pursuing outside preservation funding, we can leverage the history of Lee to the benefit of its present. I want to point this out. This is an actual receipt for the hobo shed proving that it was used for hobos. This plan also takes advantage of economies of scale in several ways. It creates one large construction project rather than several small-scale renovations, which would each require remobilizing crews and more management overhead driving up costs. It also plans to create a unified town center with infrastructure such as gas, well, septic, and telecom, and shared meeting spaces, reducing build-out costs when compared to other options. It also keeps emergency and non-emergency services separate, honoring the 50-year plan for this public safety complex. And finally, this town center truly centers our town, keeping Lee a distinctly New England place by preserving our traditional town center, a town hall, public library, church, and school. These are the reasons the Select Board is pursuing this plan. This plan addresses real problems. It balances construction costs against long-term operating costs. It addresses the town's facilities needs for the long term. It capitalizes on our unique heritage. It leverages scale. It honors the town's emergency and safety commitments and preserves our town center. And I'll take any questions or concerns you have about anything overall. And I want to state that the town vote is next week, March 12th, 2019, and this project is Warrant Article 3. The town hall renovation is Warrant Article 4. Voting is from 7 a.m. to 7 p.m. here at the Public Safety Complex in the room below us. You can register to vote at the polling place that day. We'd also encourage you to follow us on Facebook and visit leetowncenter.org, where you can subscribe to updates and share your feedback with us. We'll now try our best to answer all of your questions and hear your concerns. Yes?
If it gets voted down, what are you going to do with the problem of building the
gap? That is something that the Select Board will have to instruct our committee. So I think that's an important question to ask the Select Board, but it's, from my position, all I can say is we were told to do this.
If this building here was planned for about 50 years, what's the year estimate for what we're building? How long do we think that will serve the town?
Okay. In the space needs assessment, the town staff was asked to look forward to 2035. For what the space needs would be through 2035. And so it's those figures for 2035 that we're using here. And there's actually very little increase in, very, very little increase in town staff. And we've pointed out the increase in meeting space. That seems to be the one that's growing and growing. I mean, it seems like we have a new committee added every 2 or 3 years, or every couple of years. So it's not the building design and the structure would be good for 50 years, but no one was looking at like town staff being 50 years.
Mm-hmm. We figure beyond 2035, the crystal ball gets a little hazy and you're unable to forecast much farther than that. But the municipal office building has been built with a simple roof line that can simply be extended. And it's been placed where it's placed so that it can be extended either to the east or to the north towards the cemetery that's right behind it. So if you had to add on, it would be add-onable rather than having to move to a totally different building or reconfigure things.
And that is also a reason for building the basements, full basements, tall full basements as condition space, so that would be available for expansion.
Yeah, start tucking things below. I don't think people will be arguing over who gets the basement.
My question still wasn't answered.
What's that?
So my question is one still wasn't answered.
What was the question?
I asked when there was a bond issued on this building and the other, and the recycling center done.
Yes. I'll highlight that, so.
It was 2024.
Come up on the 2023. Which I didn't catch it.
Blue and pink, correct.
Yeah, here shows that schedule.
That there in blue is the public safety complex bond.
23 and 24 then.
Correct, 2023 and 2024. And you can see the public safety complex bond this year is, let's say, 16 cents on the tax rate.
Yep.
And then 15, 15, 14, and 13, rounded off to the nearest penny. And then the transfer station was taken out a year later. So it's retired a year later in fiscal year 2024. And it runs 8 cents, 8 cents, 7 cents, 7 cents, 7 cents, and 7 cents, rounded off to the nearest penny.
Yes.
Yeah, what's the latest thinking on the parsonage and how it fits into the town center concept?
Okay. There is an article on the ballot to postpone the deadline for the parish house another year. The parish house, about half the parish house is in the side setback of the property. It's so close to the property line. It does not interfere with any of the new construction that's planned. So in fact, if it stays there, we didn't even have to take it into account in thinking of where to place buildings or parking areas. The Heritage Commission has asked for the extension. That building is now on the New Hampshire Preservation Alliance
7 to Save,
which is each year they identify 7 structures within the state that are slated for loss or demolition. And that they think are historically important enough to put on the 7 to Save. But plans for that were outside the scope of what the committee could consider.
Because the 2018 vote stated that the parsonage would be removed.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
So we couldn't plan to do anything with it because the voting body had said it goes as part of that warrant article. But thankfully, like John said, it's so much into the setback that it's not as though our plans call for tearing it down. So,
yeah, it's Article 16 on the ballot is a question to postpone for another year before it would have to be removed. And right now it is on town property. It's a town building. I didn't find out what's actually costing us in insurance, but the $4 million in new construction that was planned added $2,450, would add $2,450 to our insurance bill. That was a quote from our carrier. Mm-hmm. So it's probably costing us like $100. And it still has electrical service, which the church is still paying for.
There is a group of people in the Heritage Commission, also public people, that meet in terms of developing a plan for that particular structure. They've come up with a couple of different scenarios, but the idea is, one, they have to secure the legislative body, us, permission to extend that another year. And if that passes, then they're gonna look at, there's grants available to look at what we could do with that particular structure. The idea is to develop a plan and then come back next March to the legislative body and say, okay, this is what we're proposing, and see if the townspeople want to do that or not. Mm-hmm. There's grants out there for doing something to it. We could still, you know, say, you know, we don't want to do anything with it, we want to get rid of the building. You can demolish it. It costs about, in terms of our initial estimates, about $30,000. Karen Rossi from the Planning and Zoning said you can probably get a price of about $25,000 to do it. It's going to cost the town money to get rid of the structure. We have done a hazardous material assessment on it. There's two sections, one in front of the top of the porch and also on the chimney, that have asbestos in them. They're small pieces, small places, but it was a fix and they used some asbestos material in it. That's the only two places or two things that was noticed in the hazardous material assessment we had done. So that's the plan. There's no concrete, but it's the article number 16 to give them those particular groups, that particular group, opportunity to find out something to do with that. If the legislative body says no, then it has to be removed.
Anything else? Any other questions?
Nothing. I want to thank Cord for struggling through, even though I'm being sick. He got through the whole thing, but he did a very nice job. And also John for answering all your questions.
Thank you.